Load.
Load.
Vent clear.
Part of the battlefield called Ruggles Line, where General Ruggles got 62 Confederate cannons lined up to fire on the Hornet's Nest and the sunken road area. So the artillery played a very important part here. Well, the first two guns are 12-pounders, which was much more heavy ordnance than the second two. The 6-pounders are both, all four of them are field guns. They just have a different size bore, shoot a different projectile.
Fire.
The National Military Park here was established in 1894. The 1890s was one of the decades that really preservation was pushed in the United States. You have these veterans, they're getting older in the 1890s, and they're starting to think about their own mortality, and they want to preserve their battlefields and leave something for future generations, much akin to, of course, what we're seeing now with the World War II generation.
I'm a more or less a generic Confederate general. The coat, though, and the stripe configuration I got from a photograph of General Sterling Alexander Martin Wood, who was an Alabama general here in this battle. And there is a photograph of him taken a few months before with this blue coat.
You had several major figures here. Presidents of the United States, General Ulysses S. Grant was the Army Union Army of the Tennessee commander here. Famous Confederate officer Albert Sidney Johnson was the commanding officer here. He was actually killed during the battle. And you had several other luminaries that would become famous afterwards. Ambrose Bierce was here, the famous writer. Henry Morton Stanley, who Dr. Livingston, I presume, he was a soldier here. Just several others. You had several luminaries. And it was a battle of epic proportion, and a lot of people, of course, began their career writing about this battle and their experiences in the battle, and later on would write even more about it.
This was the first time most of their troops were in the fight, and the terrain here is so congested. You know, you have some fields, but you got a lot of woods. And so many things were spread out and so much chaos going on. Even in victory, the first day, the Confederates were experiencing a lot of confusion.
Solid shot was used against long-distance troops or fortifications. The shell and spherical case were explosive shells. The canister was like a large shotgun shell projectile that had 29 iron balls contained in it. Devastating. The men back in those days were made of a different fiber. To attack an artillery piece shooting canister at you was just instant death.
Okay, the Battle of Shiloh was fought on April 6th and 7th, 1862. This was about a year into the war, so it's just getting started. There's been several small battles before this, but this is the first big bloodbath during the war. It starts out the big long list of huge battles. In fact, this battle produces 23,746 casualties in 2 days, and it was absolutely a bloodbath. And the sad thing is, of course, later on you have more of these battles that come along every month or so, just with different names and more casualties, actually, as armies get larger.
Well, the bugle served the function of our modern radio operators. We were able to communicate across the field and send orders back and forth, exchange information, and basically carry on a conversation at great distances. We understand now how sound wave works, but they didn't. All they knew is they could hear a bugle. There's a lot of high-pitched sound in the battlefield of bullets shrieking through the air, because you can hear the sounds of the bullets passing through the air, and there's a lot of low-pitched sounds of guns rumbling and exploding, but there's a broad range of sound that's empty in the battlefield, and that's the area that the bugle occupies. So I don't have to play all that loudly to be heard at a great distance, because that frequency range is empty. So the sound carries very well. I have been heard playing 3 miles away.
The field hospital would have chloroform and ether and whiskey for pain and to knock the patients out as an anesthetic. They used the chloroform more. It took effect quicker. It lasted longer. It didn't make them as sick as the ether did, but a lot more of the soldiers died from overdose of chloroform. The field hospital had very few female nurses. The female nurses would usually have been a nurse that followed a doctor that she had worked with. Then they organized the first consolidated hospital in the United States right here at Shiloh. And that meant that all the small regimental hospitals came together as one group and formed a huge hospital because there were so many casualties here. Mostly it would be amputations because those body parts had to be removed within a 48-hour period of time to keep down the gangrene. Once they had gangrene, most of the soldiers died from it. They used some horsehair if they gave out of their suturing material. And really the beginning of sterilization of sutures happened in the field hospital with the horsehair. They boiled the horsehair to make it soft and to make it stay tied, and that was really the only thing clean in the hospital, in the field hospital. They just didn't realize the effect that germs were having. That was before their time.
If they were lucky, they had hardtack and possibly a beef jerky that the cooking of the Confederates would have been somewhat more primitive than the Northern troops had. I would think that they'd bring biscuits and various things from home that would last for a period of time. They had some canned stuff. The North had a much better diet, canned meats, canned vegetables, canned fruits, that they were well fed. And it's always been said that an army travels on its stomach, and the army that's fed and cared for the best in the end will probably be the victor.
We would follow the military if the houses got burnt. We would follow the military for safety reasons, too. We have our bathhouse over there and our kitchen, and then, of course, all the tents lined up for where we sleep. This tent here, we're actually doing churning butter, and my mom's tatting and knitting and cross-stitch.
Would have taken what you could have carried either horseback or by wagon. So that's what this is. The floor is made out of burlap bags that either had peanuts or straw in it, sewn together by twine. The bed is made out of wood with willow feet, and then the quilts. The traveling trunk in the back actually is from the 1800s. It is a woman's traveling chest, and the way you can tell is because the bevel of the trunk would have indicated women due to the hats and stuff like that being in it.
The subject's interesting, but the rhymes are mighty wild.
Oh, yeah.
our wives and sweethearts, and gobble gloom and bees.
In all cases, it was a Union victory. Some Southerners claim that since they drove the Union back to Pittsburgh Landing and basically withdrew unmolested on the second day, that it was a tactical victory and so on. But any way you spin it, it's pretty much a Union victory.
Well, my uniform is a U.S. Navy lieutenant, and we're here to discuss the naval aspects of the battle because Tyler and Lexington were present during this battle and also its preceding one on March 1st. There are actually two battles of Shiloh here, and both of them are Navy victories. It's our contention, and the history books will prove us out, that the Navy played not only a pivotal role here, but a decisive role. Both Beauregard on the southern side and Grant and Lincoln on the northern side, if you read the after-action reports, credit those two gunboats with saving Grant's army. Both here at Shiloh and at Malvern Hill a few weeks later, those are two places where the South should have, would have, and could have, except for those gunboats, have gained their independence, and I'd be in a foreign country. And the Southerners themselves said it 2 weeks after this battle. The Daily Delta down in New Orleans wrote the epitaph for the entire Southern war effort. They said, "We have nothing to fear from Union armies, so long as they can be divorced from their gunboats." That's the equation that nobody in the South could figure out. Lee came closest. Probably our best American general. He came closest and realized that after Malvern Hill, which is a battle similar to this one where he lost to the gunboats, he tailored his strategy to fight above the line of waterfalls coming off the Appalachians. It's the only way to cut the Yankee Navy out. And except for Gettysburg and Appomattox, he didn't lose too many other battles to the Yankee Army when the Navy was taken out of the equation.
The Confederates withdrew to Corinth and basically left later in May of 1862. So this is the battle for Corinth. And more importantly, this is the battle for those Confederate railroads down there. The battle here dooms Corinth. And that, of course, Corinth, and which outflanks Memphis, Tennessee, that becomes kind of the staging area and the launching point for Grant's Vicksburg campaign there. So this is a stepping stone in the Union effort to clear out the Mississippi Valley.
This is one of the times of the year when we really get a double dose of enjoyment, because not only are we out here educating the public, which we like to do, but we're on sacred ground. And there's nothing, you know, I like to be on sacred ground just in street clothes, but being able to do it in uniform is just a real thrill.
This is my unpaid job, but it's a lot more worthwhile and lasting. We do this just to teach, just for the chance to talk to people. We take part in the battles, but they're not the focus for us.
Our unit and the participants here today are very honored to be on Shiloh National Military Park. As descendants of Confederate soldiers, we're trying to honor our ancestors and for the crowd recreate what the soldiers went through and the devastation of war.
I've been on just about every battlefield in the country, and Shiloh, I don't know why, my ancestor was here, but he wasn't hurt, but this battlefield affects me like no other. It's just, there's just so much death here, I don't know what it is, but this Shiloh is a special place.